present to you tonight. My name is Frank Riccardi. I'm a project manager with Weston & Sampson Engineers in Peabody, Mass., and we're happy to have a long-standing history working for the City of Lynn and EDIC in particular on a number of issues and projects and whatnot, so we're very pleased to be here again tonight. We are going to be presenting our Lynn Coastal Resiliency Study and the work that we've done to date. We're very happy to be studying the Lynn shoreline and evaluating sea level rise impacts and storm surge effects along the Lynn shoreline. We're very happy to have received a coastal zone, Massachusetts Coastal Zone Management Grant, and we're happy to have Catherine Glenn here tonight from CZM, who is making this project possible. We're happy that Mary Jane Smalley and Bill Bochnack from Lynn EDIC are here, who had the foresight to really go after, and Jim Cowdell as well from Lynn EDIC, to look at this issue and start to evaluate sea level rise impacts along the shoreline, because Lynn has a very active plan for looking at shoreline issues and a master plan along the shoreline and the coastline. So this study will go a long way in identifying vulnerable areas and impacts related to sea level rise. So the team that's here tonight includes myself, project manager, and Rob Almy, who's a technical lead on the study for Weston & Sampson. And we're partnered with Anchor QEA, who is a premier oceanography and ocean engineering firm out of Andover and Beverly, I believe, right? And we have Erin Healy, who will be talking about some of the technical aspects of the project, and Mark Mahoney, a Lynn native, current Swampscott resident, provide some insight along the Lynn coastline and things we'll be looking at specifically. Okay, so other folks that are in the room that are involved in the project and on the working groups are Rihanna Hughes from Lynn Water and Sewer, Joan LeBlanc from the Saugus River Watershed Council, and I believe, is everyone else a resident, or do we have any other stakeholders in the project? I think that's it. So welcome to all the concerned residents and people interested. So the purpose of tonight is to inform you about the study and the technical details. What are the databases and the studies and reports that we're looking at to form the basis of the vulnerability assessment. Tell you about the progress we've made to date, and most importantly, get your comments, concerns, and hear from you about your experiences in Lynn, and if you have any specific concerns about sea level rise and inundation, we'd love to hear from you. I think I've introduced all those folks formally, so we can move on. And again, Lynn EDIC prepared a grant for the Coastal Zone Management to look at this issue. There is a nice program that Coastal Zone Management puts on, and a funding source that is active and available for all coastal communities. And a number of communities up and down the Massachusetts shoreline have received grants to look at these impacts and look at vulnerable areas and impacts and project some modeling and try to identify areas that need some additional study and some love going forward so that sea level rise is taken into account. And Lynn was lucky enough to receive, or not lucky, worthy enough to receive a $73,000 grant to study this issue and look specifically at vulnerable areas, at infrastructure along the shoreline, and see how their master plan, coastline master plan, should be considered moving forward for the study. So, Rob, you gonna take it from here? Thank you.
Thank you, Frank. One of the things we wanna do is talk a little bit about why we're here and why we're doing this work. We're going to use available information about sea level rise, and we're gonna apply it to the city of Lynn specifically using the best information we have. We have some examples on the side of information that we have available. We're working with the city to augment that information electronically, so we have a base of facilities and topography and land uses that we can then use against predicted sea level rise. The idea here is to allow the city to move forward with its plans in its waterfront area with this new information on sea level rise and how it might affect those plans and the facilities and infrastructure that you already have. I think it's obvious that Lynn is a coastal community. The city has tremendous opportunities out there. A little closer, okay. I'm used to being able to be heard without a microphone, so I don't pay a lot of attention to what the thing is. And some of the areas the city has done a good job working on, other areas it has plans, and we want to make sure that we help the city realize as much as it can using rational planning horizons. And specifically, we're going to use a 25 and a 50-year planning horizon, and Aaron will talk a little bit about what that means. Lynn is a changing community. The photograph on the left was taken about 80 years ago. They're unloading lumber and drying the sails of a schooner. That's an older use of the waterfront. Among the plans that have been implemented, I include a high-speed ferry over to Boston, and there are a lot of other opportunities that the city has been looking at as well, and we want to make sure that those opportunities can be realized. I mentioned baseline information. We're going to use information that's available to us. We're not going to invent a lot of new things. The city has worked with us, and we're using their GIS information and the Commonwealth's GIS information and information that we have developed over the years. I'm sorry. GIS is a geographic information system, and it's basically layers of information that are referenced to certain points on the surface. So you can layer information, topography over land use, inundation areas over land use accurately and determine what facilities are at risk. The GIS replaces what I used to use as Mylar layers years ago. It's fast, it's handy, it allows you to update the information easily, and it's terrifically accurate. And we have a couple of examples here. On the left is zoning that the city has instituted for their waterfront area, and on the right is a bathymetric survey that was done, and it shows some of the channels and access to the city's waterfront. We are also using planning documents. The city has a number of plans. They have land use plans, they have open space plans, there's a harbor master plan, and there are emergency response or hazardous reduction plans. It's important that we look at those plans and we look for an opportunity to make them as useful as possible as conditions change. A land use plan serves one of several purposes. For example, a general plan will often reflect the community's notion of where it wants to be, what it wants to look like. A hazardous reduction plan is designed to respond to certain known hazards and keep its citizens as safe as possible in the event of certain storms and other kinds of disasters. And again, we're going to look at all of these plans and see those opportunities for make them as functional as possible with the new information about sea level rise. And now I'd like to introduce Mark Mahoney. He's going to talk a little bit about the sources of information, and he will lead into a discussion of what that information looks like by Aaron.
Good evening. What I'd like to do is walk around and inventory the Lynn shoreline, some of the associated infrastructure, as we get started here and talking about the information sources that we pull into this. So what we'll do is we'll start at the Swampscott line and we'll work our way around the shoreline, working our way to the south. It's going to be a bit of a challenge to turn my head and talk into this microphone. What's that?
You want to go around and stand in front of the podium?
Yeah, I think that might work better. If you guys can bear with me while I pop over this, but I'm a little too old for that.
Might kick me in the face, too.
This is my morning run most days, so I'm very familiar with this stretch of shoreline, much more so than when I'm working in other areas of the world. So what we'll do is we'll start up here, like I say, in the vicinity of Swampscott and work our way down. I think most of us are familiar with Lynn Beach. Lynn Beach is a concrete seawall in back of a sandy beach. So it's a relatively flat, very low-profile sandy beach that has remained very stable throughout the years. It's not very susceptible to erosion. The level of sand on the beach, the elevation of sand on the beach, has stayed pretty much the same. As we work our way down towards Red Rock Park, we run into some rocky shoreline, but again, the seawall continues, and that continues all the way down to the Nahant Rotary. And again, we have a relatively sandy beach. Those of us who know the beach well know that this is the area where we have the little Piliella littoralis, the algae problem. Then we work our way down along the Nahant Causeway. The Nahant Causeway, I mentioned, is significant to this study because this causeway, which connects Lynn and Nahant, also functions with the beach, the back beach area, which is mostly sand dunes, vegetated sand dunes, and the causeway, to protect the harbor, in particular from northeasters. You know, this direction is north, this direction out here is to the east. So in the northeast is when winds and waves come in this way. The causeway is a pretty effective barrier in the rest of Nahant and protects Lynn Harbor. So that's the significance of the causeway with regard to this study. Then as we work our way around further to the south and the Lynnway along here, we begin to go from a transition from residential areas along Lynn Shore Drive into more commercial areas along the Lynnway. In here, we have marinas, we have a restaurant, we have some unused land up here and warehouses and industrial and commercial spaces down here. We have the National Grid facility for the storage and transmission of liquefied natural gas. And then as we continue our way along the shoreline on this side of Lynn Harbor, this is all bulkheaded along here. We have the wastewater treatment plant, the creamery, the former landfill that has been capped along here, some unused land down here near the mouth of the Saugus River. And as we turn and head up into the Saugus River, we begin to encounter GE. On this side, this is all undeveloped on this side of the harbor. And you can see the harbor faces to the south, into the west. So the harbor is somewhat susceptible to hurricanes, storms that come from this direction, but that's cut off somewhat by a limited fetch because of the presence of Boston and the mainland to the south, which is located off this land. So that's a quick inventorying of the shoreline and the infrastructure that we have. Quite a bit of infrastructure in here. I think I was remiss in not mentioning the ferry terminal up in this neck of the woods up here at the north end of the harbor. And you can see the channel that's been dredged and maintained to allow access to this portion of the waterfront for the ferry. So that's it. Aaron, you're going to jump up now?
Yeah.
And I can turn this back around for you if you want to do this side. Or
I just wanted to take a step back and go over how the study is being done. There's three tasks in it, and this is the first public meeting. This is to talk about what we did during task one. Task one is basically going out, gathering information. Information comes in kind of two different forms. One electronic, and one is other studies that we looked at and synthesized and put together a summary that'll go into our report. There's going to be a final report for this project, and there'll be three interim technical memoranda. We have a very tight schedule for this, so we're going to be working quickly. And I'm going to describe to you what the next steps are at the end of this. But just as an overview, task one is information synthesis and gathering it. We put it in the GIS, and then we do a synthesis and a summary in written form. And we also look at the scenarios we're going to use. The scenarios for future conditions include sea level rise, and then on top of that, what the storm surge is. And that's what I'm going to walk through right now, how we came, we got to those scenarios. You're not going to see maps today showing water, what we call inundation, which is how the extent of the water that would come up and the depth of the water. That will be presented at the next public meeting. So as I said, we one of the key parts of this task is to look to gather data sources, and what we did here was just put a few of them up so that you could kind of get a feel for what they look like. These sources of information are readily available. They're actually pretty easily digested too and easily read. This is looking at preparing for the storm, which is about coastal resiliency. DCR right there is Department of Conservation and Recreation for Massachusetts. And they, what they did was go through the state and inventory all the infrastructure that protects the coastline so that we have an idea of where that is, what it looks like. The ASA report is a similar type study that was done for another city down in the southeastern Massachusetts. And then you see at the bottom is the beginning of our GIS. If you come to the next two public meetings, you're going to be seeing more maps that are generated out of our GIS. This is another slide just showing some of the data and information. When we look at sea level rise, we are not climate scientists. That's being done globally. There's lots of information out there. There's lots of uncertainty. We're not generating any new information on that. All we're doing is using existing information. That the document on the left there is this one here. It's referred to as the Paris Report. And basically, that's the report that NOAA, U.S. Geological Society, USGS, I should know that, I'm a geologist, and the Army Corps of Engineers put together. And that's really the main reference that we use for determining what scenarios you look at for climate change. The middle two are from the Coastal Zone Management here in Massachusetts, very easily read guidance documents that build off the federal work. And then over here we have a report that was done by the Saugus River Watershed. Really great source of information if you're interested in climate change and how it affects you locally. Really good reference to go look at. It's on their website. So now I'm going to run through how we came up with our scenarios. The scenarios have three different components. Future global sea level rise. That's due to climate change, that's due to increased temperature and ice melt, and that's what I was talking about is done by the climate scientists, and the main source is that Paris document that we referred to. The regional sea level rise is historical information. We get that by looking at the tide gauge, and for Lynn, we're looking at Boston Harbor. Even though the future global sea level rise is what's going to happen in the future. The regional sea level rise is what's happening locally. There's already some sea level rise recorded. In addition to sea level rise from climate change, you also have relative sea level rise because we're still going through rebound from the glaciers. And so we're having rebound in this area. And then storm surge, as you know very well, living on the coast of Massachusetts, that storm surges cause a lot of water to come inland. So when we look at future sea level rise scenarios, we also want to put storm surge on top of that. So those are the three components. This is the first component. This is what was put out in the Paris document, and it's estimated future sea level rise. The way that they show these are these curves. This right here is a rate. So this is global mean sea level rise centimeters above 1992. So this is how many centimeters that the sea level is rising above 1992, just as a baseline. And this is the year. So here's 2000. 92 is here. And we are in here. So right at the beginning of it. So the climate scientists got together internationally and came up with these estimates. This is the high scenario. This is a worst possible case, full melting of the ice cap. And this is the low scenario, which is kind of like, you can think about it as baseline. That's based on the Boston Harbor, locally in Boston Harbor. That's based on historical information. So that's our current rate of sea level rise. And then there's two estimates here based on different climate change scenarios. And by climate change scenarios, I mean how much ice will melt, how much temperature will rise. And so there's different, scientists come up with different estimates, basically. So you can see there's quite a bit of range here. And that range translates into uncertainty in the numbers. So what we are proposing to do is look at this intermediate high and the low. So what that will provide for the city is a bracket of a potential low and a potential high. It's not the highest, as you see, but we feel that for the purposes of this study and a screening analysis, the project team thought that this was a reasonable scenario. The other components we're looking at are time horizons. You notice on the curve, the time is on the bottom axis. And so you have to figure out how many years out you want to look at. We decided the climate, the project team decided 25 years for short-term adaptation planning, and 50 years, which is the average life cycle time for municipal infrastructure. I just want to point out this word adaptation, which is kind of, in a way, jargon related to climate change work. Adaptation is basically just changes or modifications that you make to increase the protection against the effects of climate change. On the coastline, you say we want to increase the coastal resiliency, which makes you, it protects the area, not necessarily by putting up a barrier, but maybe working with the water, but it integrates the aspects of climate change and the increasing sea level that could come about. And then, as I said before, the sea level rise projections we're using are the NOAA lowest and intermediate high from that graph we just looked at. The other piece, if you recall, there were three pieces in that first slide that we looked at, is storm surge. And this is, and the regional sea level rise. This is actually the data from the Boston Harbor tide gauge. What the tide gauge does is it just sits there and the water level is recorded. So you can see we've got a long record back to almost 1920 to present. And this is the change in water elevation. And so anytime you see a spike, you're getting a storm. Where it's down around this area here is a normal tidal fluctuation, high tide to low tide. This peak right here, anybody want to guess what that is? Yeah, blizzard of 78. In storm jargon, we refer to storms as 100-year storms, 10-year storms. Blizzard of 78 is what's referred to as a 100-year storm. So there's a 1% chance any year that a 100-year storm would occur, or one storm expected in 100 years. So the next portion of this, that's what we did under task one, is come up with proposed scenarios, and we did this as a working group with coastal zone management reviewing our work. The next task will be what's pretty much described here, is we're gonna take the scenario, we're gonna estimate inundation depth. So that's gonna give the extent and the depth of water. And then we're gonna put that on top of the infrastructure inland, in the coastline. And from there, we'll identify critical infrastructure and identify vulnerabilities and risk. And that process will be presented in the next working meeting, or the public meeting, I'm sorry. So, what's next? So the first thing that we need to talk about is, well, what you need to talk about is we're looking for input. When Massachusetts Coastal Zone Management put together their guidance, and also when the federal government put together the guidance, public input is key to the process, and that's why we're having three public meetings, you know, for a very short-term project. We're looking for input at each step along the way, because this is a community endeavor. It's something that's going to affect the community and really many different aspects of people's lives. So the public outreach and the educational part, and also the participation and feedback that you can give us, is really important. Any questions that you have tonight or in the future, you'll have an opportunity to ask them. Any input or suggestions you have on the study, we'd like to hear from you. And if you do have any questions, this is the email address in the city and EDIC that we'd like you to send the questions from, and then Mary Jane's going to direct those questions to the right person. So that ends our presentation. We're looking for comments, suggestions. Anybody have any questions for any of us? Yes.
Yes, I'm. This is one of my pet projects. I know that I won't be alive to see whatever happens, but that doesn't mean I'm not concerned. Just a couple of comments. One, I think you referred to the low, medium, and high with those curvy lines. No, not that one. The one. Yes. And I may have misunderstood you, but I thought that it was kind of saying that that these projections were because scientists had different views of what might happen. That's where I disagree. I think that the differences are related to how seriously we take it, because there are tipping points that if we don't do something by such and such a time, we missed our shot, as they say in Hamilton. The other thing, I'm glad you're looking at maps and stuff. Are you familiar with Climate Change Central? What is it? Climate Central. ClimateCentral.org. Surging seas maps. Yes. Oh, good. I think it's a terrific website. I go to it. I put in my zip code. And then I see where the water will be if we do nothing. Or if we take things really seriously and clamp down and shut down and get our LEDs and our cars and our public transport and our solar power. This summer, my community solar farm starts. I'm so excited. But I do think it's the educational component about what we have to do to get serious is the most important piece. That's all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Jay Walsh. I'm the city councilor for Ward 7, which is encompassing a lot of the river up there. I've lived there my entire life. I can tell you that the sea level has risen. I'll tell you that from my perspective of even from some of my fishing expeditions I've done, we're actually catching different fish now, so it kind of tells me that water temperature is changing also. I just want to say that when we get up to the river in that area there, that is an area of critical environmental concern. It's a concern for a lot of us. It's also a buffer for a lot of the storm surge that you're going to see with these 100-year storms. So whatever we do with the waterfront out front, is going to affect the river and the ACEC, and I just want to make sure that we take that into consideration. Also, I'm looking to see a few of my constituents here, too, who have concerns about their backyard flooding and stuff like that further up the river. So we just have to be able to calculate the impacts that are going to affect the river in a natural state and for people who live up the river farther. All right? Thank you very much.
I'm glad you brought that up because we really left the river out a little bit, but our study area extends the whole shoreline of Lynn. So we are going up the river. The model, per se, doesn't integrate the river flows, but we are going to look at that. So that will be integrated in and discussed. So we'll look forward to your input, you know, when we get to the next step. That's great. Thank you.
Also, we've been working with DCR as well, Mike Galvin. He is transmitting all of the ACEC info, the causeway info, into our database, so we will have that information to incorporate into the study. So. And I think, Joan, your study actually has a lot of information on that. And we are meeting on Thursday with the City of Revere to get them up to speed on what we're doing and hopefully continue this study down the shoreline in the future.
I'm actually one of the residents under Ward 7, and I've lived there now 3 years. My wife's family's been there for over 55. They've actually noticed the difference. Not only is the yard at times, like, I can kid you not, you're swimming, I'm standing on my land. Yeah. So there's the difference of actually the way I'm affected, and it's not just my yard, it's actually my front street. And we are able to handle 12.5-foot tides on average. We actually have to monitor where we park our cars, understand what the tides are, what the surge is going to be. We have to try and predict where it's going to go and watch. And my front steps go underwater all the way up my entire street as things have not only risen but settled over years and years and years of corrosion and things just eating away at the land. My concern is that, like Jay said, how are we actually planning when we dredge for a ferry? How many inches can that really matter? Those types of things are what I wonder if we can take consideration. When I actually have the DPW out there, they literally have told me, you're only one house. It's not something you want to hear when you're trying to get out of your driveway and there's nothing but sea in front of you. How many jellyfish did we count last week? Just left on the street after the tides go back out. It's one of those things that we wonder far in, because we always worry about the beaches and the coastal areas and the walls, but yet the inner areas are always what get most affected by these couple inches here and there.
Yeah, I'll say it. The house where I live, my living room is 8 feet above mean high water. Oh, sorry. I live right over the line in Swampscott, and my living room is 8 feet above mean high water. I've lived there since 1994. And the ocean never came down the street until the last 5 years. And in the last 5 years, it's come down the street more times than I can count. I was backing out of the yard one day, beautiful December day, with my daughter. I was taking her to some sort of function. And she said, Daddy, why is there water in the street? And I looked, and there were waves actually coming down the street in a sunny day just because of a high astronomical tide and a little bit of wind offshore that was building the ocean up. So I know exactly what you're talking about. And that's the type of thing I think that we have to plan for, we have to account for, is in these low-lying areas, what are we going to be seeing as sea level continues to rise?
Hello. Hi, I'm Joan from Saugus River Watershed. It's sort of awkward having you back to everyone. First off, thanks so much for the effort that's ongoing. This couldn't be more timely right now with so much of Lynn's waterfront poised for development. There couldn't be a better time. I mean, I think if we were to ask any of the property owners in downtown Boston, would they have liked to do this sort of study 25 years ago so that they wouldn't be sandbagging when there's a rainstorm, I think they would have said yes. So thanks for moving forward on this, and it's really important.
Can you put up the slide with the scenario?
Yes.
Scenarios. Similar to Jay's comments, we're seeing, first I should back up. I work for the Saugus River Watershed Council. I know a lot of people here. We're a nonprofit. We focus on trying to protect and restore the natural resources in the watershed, which encompasses all of the river and a lot of Lynn, all of Saugus, and several other communities. So we've been working with a lot of different communities in the watershed to try and provide information about climate change and how it might affect watershed resources. We've seen already some big changes. Just for example, we look at habitat for different species, and one of them is rainbow smelt. We've done a smelt spawning habitat survey, and we're actually seeing that the locations where the smelt lay their eggs are moving upstream. And the reason for that is that they're looking for brackish waters. They look for a very specific habitat, a rocky substrate in the river, but one that's also brackish. And so the saltwater tidal pulse is moving upstream, and we're seeing that with the species. So there's definitely some anecdotal and specific information saying that, you know, this is already happening. So it's great that you're moving forward with this. I just wanted to say, I understand you have to pick, maybe not looking at every possible scenario, but if it were possible, personally, I think it would be great to take a look at the high scenario. Not that I'm a doomsdayist, but I do think it's helpful because we have the opportunity now, especially because there's so much area that has not yet been developed. So there's an opportunity to really integrate specific design and construction strategies that could protect both the environmental and the economic resources going forward. So it might be worth a look on that. And thanks very much.
Any other input? Yes, ma'am.
I look at my maps here, and I see this rising water, and I see how the Linway and Summer Street and those places, they're going to be wet, okay? They just are. So I wonder why we are having a Linway development, you know? It just is a very big question mark in my mind when this seems to say, you know, maybe not within the next 25 years, but probably within the next 50, it's gonna be ocean.
It's a good point, and a lot of the modeling will show that those roads are inundated. But the next part, and hopefully the next study that we do, will take the results of this study and start to plan strategies for adapting the coastline. So, for example, a building, there's ways to invite water through a building. You move the mechanical systems up to higher floors, you make the lower floors open, and water can come in and out. So you look for strategies to take advantage of those types of situations. There's hard techniques, there's soft techniques, and we call, like, you know, seawalls and stuff like that, but we really want to focus on natural areas where we can invite water into, you know, where there's not impact to developed areas or to homes or to businesses. So that is very much part of the studies that will come out of this study. So it's not doomsday scenario. It's basically, let's be smart about what is going to happen and are there opportunities to improve it. So hopefully we have a better story and outcome than just living with water. So I guess I'm an optimist. I don't know. And that's another piece, too, is you really look at the critical infrastructure, emergency shelters, you know, thoroughfares, you know, pump stations, things like that, that you really want to protect and figure out strategies to deal with that as well. We're not convincing you tonight, I know. Anything else? Any other comments? Yes, Joan. Erin, do you want to take that one? I'm not exactly sure where this ends in the, I'm an engineer, so that gets into the.
Adaptation planning is part of this project. And so we'll get into the beginning of that. This is really a screening process, though. This is the start, not the end. So this is meant to lay a groundwork, the groundwork to build on, and also to improve as information becomes more available. So we do get into some planning, yeah. And by planning for the nine engineers is kind of some concepts and some ideas that we that can be developed, sorry, that we can be developed and presented and look at feasibility analyses, and then you'd go into design of something. And as Frank said, what I think everybody is aiming for is not necessarily just a wall, but integrating the natural coastline into ways that we can deal better with a rising sea. In some places that might be what we call the hardened coastline, which could be a hard wall, and other places that might be soft, maybe increasing hydraulic storage by wetland restoration. So there's lots of different options, and those options are becoming more numerous as people develop them. Ideas about wave attenuation and offshore apparatus that can be used, living shorelines. So we want to look at all of it. And that's the idea. You start, you take a look at it, and you take one step forward, and then go from there. Did everyone sign in? Okay. We have a sign-in sheet here. We gave you an email. We'll also be putting up a website. The information that's generated out of this project will be posted to the website, including meeting minutes. At the end of the project, there'll also be a web-enabled mapping system where you'll be able to go in interactively and look at things. The idea for that is not to stop there. Again, it's to take it forward and use it as a living tool. We want to thank you all for coming tonight. Did you want to say anything? No? Okay. And we'll look forward to seeing you at the next meeting. Bring your friends. The
next meeting is in March, I believe. March 29th.
Oh, that's right, March 29th.